Okay, so here we are once again discussing some important stuff once again. And praise be to God, we have again with us my brother, Pastor Christopher George, and we're going to have an awesome time discussing some important things this evening. About repentance. So yesterday we started off with what we said about grace, the hyper grace, and Pastor Christopher shared his testimony, his journey about hyper grace, how he took on grace into his life, these teachings of grace. So before we really speak about these things, let's wait for our viewers to come in. Let's wait for our viewers to come in. Let's check, share on the Facebook to all our viewers.
Yes, sure.
So if viewers are there, please share it. Share to Okay. So praise God. Praise God. We have Zita online. Praise God. And praise God, Zita. Yeah. So as the viewers are getting in, Christopher, let's
Yes.
take up this topic today about repentance, because
Yes.
in the body
Yes.
of Christ, many people have a different view when they look at repentance. Many think that grace preachers who preach the grace message, the grace gospel, they really don't believe in repentance and all that stuff. So this evening, let's discuss on this
Yes.
important topic called as
Yes.
repentance. So according to you,
Yes.
what do you want to share about repentance?
Yeah, I just wanted to say when it comes to repentance, as we are a grace preacher, I wanted to give repentance in a covenant basis. In
Okay.
the old covenant, how the repentance falls and how the new covenant the repentance falls. Then the old covenant repentance is that is like God saying to his people, come back to me and return unto me, then I will return unto you.
Yeah.
That's the old covenant way of repenting.
Okay.
The new covenant way of repenting,
Yeah.
I have already come to you. I have already accepted you. I have already blessed you. I have already forgiven all your sins. So come back to us, come back to me, because everything is ready for you. Okay, I'll give you a word of God for that. Okay,
Yeah.
Isaiah chapter 44, verse 22. I'll read it from the NLT version.
Yes.
I have swept away your sins like a cloud.
Okay.
The God is giving a call for repentance to his people. He's saying, even before he could call them for repentance, he does something on the basis of what he has done. Okay, we can call it the finished work of Jesus Christ. And he is calling the people. He's saying, I have swept away your sins like a cloud, your sins are done with, and I have scattered your offenses like the morning mist. Okay,
Wow.
the way morning mist is disappearing when the sun comes, it is like that. Your offenses are gone. Oh, now, oh, return to me. Now he's calling. He's giving he's calling for a repentance for the people. He's going to return unto me, for I have paid the price to set you free.
Wow.
Okay, so in the new covenant way of repentance is that we repent and come back to God because our sins are already forgiven, our transgressions are paid off, and everything is done deal. Now, the thing is that when the repentance will become heavy and burden for you, the day you believe, now I have to repent, then I have to pray, then God will forgive me my sins, and that's the time the repentance will become burden in your life. Yeah, the day you believe,
that's the old covenant repentance, right? What you're saying.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
It is where you're saying, come on, ask for forgiveness of your sin, cry about your sin. First and foremost, look how many sins you have done, then have repent for your sins, and then come to God, and then God will forgive your sins. This is the old covenant way of repentance. Very good. Okay, then go ahead, Christopher.
So that's what this word of God in Isaiah chapter 44 verse 22 clearly says, return to me because I have already forgiven your sins. So we have assurance to come back to God. God is saying that, come to me, my dear child. Now, I'm not going to talk to you anything about your sins, because we think that when we go back to God, God will take a big list of my sins and ask, why have you done this? Why have you done this? God says, I have forgiven all your sins. I have blotted it out and I removed it out. And I remember your sins no more. I remember your sins no more. So I have reconciled myself with you in Christ Jesus. So come back to me. Let us enjoy the relationship that we have. Once we understand, that's why the Bible says, not that once we understand that the goodness of God, oh, God has already forgiven my sins. Bible says, when we were still sinner, he died for us. Absolutely. It's not that after we repented, he died for us. When we were still sinner, he died for us. And 2 Corinthians 5:19 says, God has reconciled the whole world unto him in Christ. Wow. Whether you are a believer, whether you are a Christian, whether you are that, whether you are this, God has already reconciled the whole world unto him in Christ Jesus. If their sins are dealt, their transgressions are forgiven, everything is done deal. Now understand this goodness of God. If you understand the goodness of God, oh, there is a God in this world who has already forgiven all my sins, then you will pick up a love for that God, and you come back to God, then you enjoy the relationship with God. And once you are in a relationship with God, that relationship with God, it brings you into the maturity, then you automatically grow in the holiness and the sanctification of God.
Wow. So, you know, the problem is people first and foremost do not understand the real meaning of the real definition of repentance. So if you see, repentance is something, you know, people think is something that you have to do to be saved. You see, that's old covenant, and that's what you're saying. Actually, we are repenting because we are saved already. In the new covenant, in the old covenant, you repent to be saved. In the new covenant, you repent because you are already saved. That's the point I think you are making.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
And the definition of repentance itself, you know, the Greek word, commonly translated for repentance, is metanoia, and which literally means to change your mind. The word repent is metanoia, which means change your mind. So if you want, you can check this out in you know, you get now mobile apps, you can check Thayer's dictionary, Smith's Bible dictionary, and all that stuff. You get the Greek word for this word, repentance, and you also will understand what it really means in Greek. So if you see in Matthew chapter 1 verse 16, it says, you know, when we read, the time has come, the kingdom of God is near, repent and believe the good news. So, you know, what is basically repentance? Repentance is not about being sin conscious. Repentance means being son conscious, being God's goodness conscious, being conscious of his kingdom, and being conscious of his good news. So if you really see, it means change your mind. It means change your mind. In other words, change your mind, change your focus. Change your focus from sin, change your focus from sin to his good news, to his kingdom. You know, and when you start focusing on him, that is God, when you start focusing on his kingdom and the good news of the gospel, that is where you say this is real repentance. This is new covenant repentance. So, you know, you understand, Christopher, we don't repent to get forgiven.
Yeah, that's what.
We repent because we are forgiven 2,000 years ago on the cross.
Yes.
So forgiveness is part of the good news.
Yeah.
And so repent and believe it. So the definition that is there about repentance, the meaning of repentance in the minds of religious people is you need to repent to be forgiven.
Yeah.
You need to be repent. You need to repent to please God. You need to repent to receive the goodness of God. But that's not the gospel. Yeah. Jesus already died 2,000 years ago. And when he died, he forgave our sins. So we repent because our sins are forgiven.
Forgiven, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
So since repentance means changing your mind, it is certainly possible that one can repent, you know, by turning from sin. And there are plenty of people in the Bible who did so. But that's only one kind of repentance, and this kind of repentance does not lead to salvation. I want to explain this.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
The old covenant, in the old covenant, repentance was turning from sins. From sin.
Okay.
So in the Bible, you see many people turned away from their sin in the old covenant. But did they get salvation?
No.
They never got salvation.
That's right.
Salvation came when Jesus died on the cross.
Absolutely.
So in the new covenant, in the New Testament, repentance typically means not turning away from sin, turning from sin. It means turning to God.
Yes.
Are you understanding?
That's right.
You see, that's the problem. That's the problem with many of us. We find it so difficult. So in the old covenant, it was turning from sin. In the new covenant, it was turning to God. So there's a huge difference. It's turning to the cross. It's about looking and focusing on the love of God, on the goodness of God.
That's right.
Yeah. I want to take our viewers today to Acts chapter 20, verse 21. Acts chapter 20, verse 21. And look what it says. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God. This is Paul now saying they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Jesus. So Paul was not preaching the gospel where he was talking about sin. You know, you need to know. He was not making people sin conscious. Rather, Paul was turning people to the gospel where he said, look at this. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, Paul was saying, the true repentance, you need to change your mind and start focusing on God and start having faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. When it says have faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, it means you need to start believing that he died for you 2,000 years ago and he forgave your sins 2,000 years ago. So
Amen.
The point Amen. I want to make tonight is this on this episode is someone who turns to God automatically turns from sin.
Yeah, Amen.
But this is the problem. But someone who turns from sin does not automatically turn to God.
That's right.
Okay, listen to this statement. Someone who turns to God automatically turns from sin and from...
Yes, Amen.
Okay, but someone who turns from sin does not automatically turn to God.
In absolutely. Words, there are so many people, holy people.
Exactly. There are other religion. There are other people who claim themselves they are holy.
Yes.
From other religion, who will say,
"I
have turned away from sin," but that doesn't mean they now believe in Jesus.
Yeah, that's right.
But people who believe in Jesus and turn themselves to God, they automatically their sins. You know, they come out of that sin. They get the grace to come out of their past sin.
Great. That's right.
You see,
so as you said, this word of God says that Paul is mentioning about having faith in Jesus. Repentance is faith in Jesus.
Yeah.
So I just want to mention one point here. Repentance is not a work. Repentance is to do your faith.
Exactly.
Okay. We think that repentance is a kind of work that we have to repent. We have to put a sackcloth and we have to go in for 7 days fasting. We have to go in for 14 days fasting. We have to do something, humble ourselves. So what happened? It goes in the work basis.
Mm.
Understand, no? So in the new covenant, what happened? You don't repent for your forgiveness of your sins. It is already forgiven.
Yeah.
So it is already forgiven on the cross. Have faith in that work of Jesus Christ. So turn your focus to that work of Jesus Christ. Just don't work. Just have faith in that work of Jesus Christ. And that's called repentance.
Yes.
Because I believe in the church today, in some of if you see some of the denomination, and they have added repentance plus penance.
Yeah.
You might have known that. Right?
Yes.
So followed by the repentance, they preach penance.
Mm.
Okay, if you go and confess your sins to that particular person, in charge person in the church, and that person will tell you, you have to do so-and-so penance.
Mm-hmm.
How can you give penance for your sins? If you can give penance for your sins, if God is going to forgive your sins and the basis of your penance, how you are going to extend onto the holy platform? You cannot give penance for your sins. The only penance, if it is there in the world, that's a penance what Jesus has paid on the cross. Put your faith in that penance and just believe in Jesus Christ. That's why repentance is not a work. Repentance is a faith.
Wow. And I just want to take you to this, scripture. It's in Luke chapter 5 verse 32. You know, it says, "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Now, religious mind look at this and call it turn from sin. Look, Jesus is saying, turn from sin. Okay, from sin. But look at this. Turning from sin doesn't make you righteous, actually.
Yeah, that's the point.
An unbeliever or people of other religion who turn from sin always remain as unbeliever.
Right.
Okay. Even if you look at the Pharisees, Pharisees, they always turned from sin. They never sinned. I mean, they made sure that they would never sin. They obeyed the Ten Commandments.
Yeah.
They were professional.
Yeah.
People who would obey all the laws and Ten Commandments.
Yes.
They ran away anytime sin appeared.
Yes.
So if anyone knew how to turn from sin, they were the Pharisees who knew it.
Yes.
But yet, Jesus called them sons of hell in Matthew chapter 23, verse 15.
That's all.
So, turning from sin will make you a moral person. But it will make you a righteous person. Righteousness comes to us through faith in Christ alone. And I emphasize the word.
Amen.
Righteousness comes only from Christ. You believe in the finished work of Christ, what he did on the cross 2000 years ago. And the day you believe it, you are righteous.
Amen.
So, you know, the old definition of repentance, people think repentance means crying over your sin. You confess about your sin. That is called true repentance according to religious mindset. Okay. But the real definition of repentance is changing your mind, not crying over your sin.
Yes.
Correct.
Absolutely.
So, and many people take this, this verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 10, it says, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. Now, this is the problem. Many religious people will read this and they read it opposite. They say repentance brings godly sorrow. They say repentance brings godly sorrow. Or they say repentance is godly sorrow. But Paul is not saying such. It says godly sorrow worketh repentance. In other words, godly sorrow and repentance are different things.
Yes.
And if you read the context, you will see that Paul was not referring to the repentance that leads to salvation here. But he was having some relational issues between him and the people in the Corinthians.
Yes.
And they had rebuked him. They felt, and then they felt bad about it, and then they repented.
Yes.
So, you know, Jesus is calling us to change our mind and believe the good news. That is true repentance.
Yes.
He is calling us to turn to turn to God.
Yeah, they were doing some mistakes, so Paul was correcting them. I think so. They are the believers.
Yes.
So as a believer, when they are doing some mistakes, he's taking authority of a leader of a church, a leader of a congregation. He's correcting them, and they accepted that somewhere they are going somewhere wrong, and they corrected themselves.
Exactly.
That's what it means in that quotation. I understand that.
Yeah. Exactly. Is there anything else you want to share?
Is there anything? See, when I was telling you, when I was in the law, that there were so many disturbances that which came because of the law mentality. So I tell you when I was searching for the real message of grace, and that time somebody gave me a book that was a Bible thing. Okay, so such a big Bible book, it had a lot of topics on it. So first topic that I took and I read it was the repentance. And in that repentance, in that book, it was written, repentance is not only initially when you repent and you become Christ. Repentance is much more once you become Christian. That is the time repentance. You need to repent every day in your life. So first of all, I was in the problem of confessing my sins every now and then. People already told me mad and all those things. So when I read this book, I was literally got scared. I closed the book. Now it's been 4 years. I never opened the book. Understand?
Yeah.
So So now we need to teach people like one more point, like they say, okay, unbeliever, they need to turn their mind that their sins are forgiven, they have to come back to God. So I wanted to teach to people, once they have become a believer, okay, so if they sin now, and what repentance means to them.
Yeah.
So I want you to tell them.
Yeah. I want to take this thing up. Yes. See, whether you are unbeliever or believer, in the new covenant, after Jesus died, the definition of repentance is same. And what is it? Change your mind. But it does change your mind means everybody. Yeah. Now, changing of the mind, everyone does. Whether you're a believer, or unbeliever. You understand? Everyone does change of the mind. But changing on your mind to what? Changing your mind, according to what Jesus is saying, changing your mind to believe that he has forgiven you 2000 years ago, changing your mind to believe in his goodness, changing your mind to believe in him. So, a person who is an unbeliever, for the person to know what is repentance, for the person to repent, he has to do is, he has to look at the cross and say, this Jesus has died for me and for my sins, and I believe in him that he has forgiven all my sin. Now that's a change of mind, you see. And now that kind of changing of mind or repentance is what brings salvation into his life.
Yes, amen.
For a believer who is already who already believes in Jesus, he repents almost every day and every moment. How? A grace-believing believer, whenever he listens to a grace sermon, whenever he listens to the good news of Jesus, whenever he reads his Bible and he looks at the cross, or he gets a revelation of the finished work of the cross, or the goodness of Jesus, or goodness of God, he is repenting. So if you ask me, yes, do I repent? I repent every day. I repent every day. When I'm preaching a sermon, when I'm preaching a sermon, I'm repenting. When I'm now, as we are online, we are repenting, because we are focusing on the goodness of God. We are focusing on the love of God. Our mind is getting changed every moment towards the goodness of God, towards the forgiveness of God, towards what he did on the cross. Every time you do that, that is repentance.
Praise God.
So honestly speaking, grace or a hyper-grace preacher is repenting more than a law people or people, religious people. Because the religious people are focusing all the time about sin, but a grace and a hyper-grace preacher, or a person who believes in the grace of God, is focusing all the time about Christ.
That's right. So
your definition of repentance will reveal whether you are living under grace or under works. Whether you're living under the old covenant or you're living in the new covenant. Old Testament sinners, you know, Old Testament sinners repented by bringing sacrifice, penance, confessing their sins. But in the new, we bring sacrifice of praise and confess his name, not the sins. And you see, Hebrews chapter 13, you see, Old Testament sinners, Numbers chapter 5 verse 7. Numbers chapter 5 verse 7, it says they would bring sacrifice of penance and confess their sin. But in Hebrews chapter 13 verse 15, The new sacrifice is a sacrifice of praise. Why we praise God? Because we are already forgiven 2,000 years ago.
Wow, amazing.
Why we confess, and we don't confess sins, we confess his name. And we will confessions. We will speak about confession of sin in the upcoming videos. But today we just want to focus more on repentance.
Yes.
Go ahead. Share something.
Yeah, so I was just going through a word of God. In that word of God, 2 Timothy 2:25, it says, in humility, correcting those who are in opposition, if God perhaps will grant them repentance, so they may know the truth. It says, in another way, it says, repentance is that knowing truth is the repentance. Okay, 2 Timothy 2:25.
Yeah.
Knowing the truth is the real repentance. Like, yeah. What is the knowing the truth? Knowing that your sins are forgiven, and that's the truth.
Yes.
And if you come to know that your sins are already forgiven,
yeah.
And if you put your faith in that, you are repentant.
Exactly.
You are repentant. And the next word of God says, and that they may come to their senses, escape the snare of the devil. He's speaking about repentance. Is speaking about the truth, and the next word of God speaking about the snare of the devil. So what I mean to say is, like, if you don't believe, if you don't know the truth that your sins are already been forgiven, then you have a chance to fall into the snare of the devil, that telling that your sins are not yet forgiven. You have to do something about your sins, then it will be forgiven, and that's the snare of the devil. Once you fall into that snare, then you're finished, gone. When you're already forgiven, when you're already forgiven, and the devil tells you, no, you're not yet forgiven, you have to do something about it, you have to repent, you have to do penance. And see, that's what happened in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve, when they are already like God, he went and told them, No, you will become like God if you eat this fruit. He told them to do something to become like God when they already become like God.
Oh,
so when our sins are already forgiven, and that repentance means that you got to, every now and then as a believer, when you fall into sins, believe even that sin that you committed just 5 minutes before, it's already been forgiven. Just believe, turn your mind into that. As you said, praise God, Lord, I regret for what I did. I don't feel like doing it. I regret for it. But I thank God you already forgiven this sin of mine. I stand in the truth. I repent myself to the truth. When you stand, when you come in that righteousness of yours, you escape from the snare of the devil. Otherwise, devil will catch you and he will tell you to repent. He will tell you to fast for 7 days. He will tell you to fast for 14 days.
Yeah.
You will lose only your weight. You will not get your real forgiveness.
Absolutely. And you know, this is what people get it wrong, Christopher, is people don't understand what does truth mean. Many people, you know, truth means right and wrong. So what is right is truth.
No.
The Bible says, Jesus says, I am the truth.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So truth does not, many people say the Bible is truth. No, the Bible is not truth. There are so many things in the Bible.
Yes.
Okay. Which is not. Jesus is the truth. And so when Jesus is saying, so as you said, repent and believe the truth means, believe in Jesus, that he died on the cross, and what he did on the cross. The
absolutely
truth means the gospel. And what is the gospel? The gospel is he died on the cross, he forgave our sins, and he rose back to life. That's the gospel. I just want to give a small a kind of an example to you and the viewers who are watching. It's like, you know, what is true repentance example would be, suppose I tell you, Christopher, now you are in North Goa and I am in South Goa. So I tell you, Christopher, you got to leave your house to come to my house. You don't know my address. And I tell you, Christopher, you got to leave your house to come to my house. So you leave your house, but you might not come to my house because you don't know the address. But if I tell you, Christopher, I'm in South Goa. I stay in so-and-so house. This is my house number. This is the area that I stay. This is my landmark. Now you will come to my house. I've not told you to leave your house. I've just given you my address. Now you will come to my house. So when we say to people, leave your sin, leave your sin, leave your sin,
they don't know where to go.
They don't know where to go. So it's like repent. Yes. When we preach the old covenant repentance about making them focus and telling, leave your sin, leave your sin, leave your sin, they are not really able to leave their sin, but they are not able to reach the destination. Okay. And what I'm saying is true repentance is you don't tell them to leave their sins, but you also, you tell them about the gospel. You tell them about the goodness of God, the real thing. You tell them to turn to God.
Yes.
You see, I remember one example. How do you make a dog leave a dirty bone from his mouth? If you go and tell the dog, please leave that dirty bone out, remove that dirty bone, remove that dirty bone. Even if you go to touch that dirty bone, the dog will come to bite you.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
So how do you make the dog leave that dirty bone? Simple. You give the best of the best food in front. You keep it in front of the dog. The dog will leave the dirty bone and eat the food.
Yes.
The best food.
You're right. You're right. Absolutely.
This is what happens in Christianity. Many Christians want to make many preachers want to, I'm not condemning them, but I'm just saying many preachers want to tell people what sin they are doing and how they need to leave their sin. So in the bargain, what happens is they try to leave, but they can't leave it.
Yes.
They are showing them that they have the dirty bone. Then everyone knows when they commit sin, what sin they do. You don't need to tell a person that he is a sinner. But here is the best thing. You need to give them the good news. You need to give them Christ. You give them the good food. So when you give them the good news, you show them Jesus Christ and you show them the love of God, that person will leave the dirty bone, will leave his sin and get hold of Christ.
Absolutely, absolutely. Awesome, awesome truth, awesome truth. I mean, I agree to that to the 100% because that had happened in my life. That had happened in my life.
So give me an example.
Come that on. Had happened. So what happened? This word, when I was the repentance was a challenge for me. There was some area in my life which I couldn't give up. Okay, I want to give up, as you say, sir. There was some dirty bone in my mouth also, so which I couldn't throw it out because that was everything for me. But I didn't have anything interesting in this world. I didn't find anything interesting in Christianity. Even Jesus is like, okay, he came, he died and he's gone. What's the big deal? If I want forgiveness, I have to pray, I have to repent, I have to kneel down, I have to fast. Then only he gives me forgiveness. He's not giving me freely, no. So nothing interesting in this Christian life.
Yeah.
So the day I understood the grace gospel, the day I understood, even before I was born, my sins were forgiven. Even before I pray, my sins were forgiven. Even before I fast, my sins. Even before I could repent, my sins. So when I understood the love of God, all the dirty bone automatically went out of my my life.
Wow.
And because now what happened? What happened? That's what I understood when I come into grace.
Yeah.
You get attracted to sin because it is very attractive to you.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yes.
Because it is very attractive because the devil portrays the sin in so nicely that it catches you. It takes your attention. But when you, sin is very attractive. But Jesus is not that much attractive because we are not preaching Jesus so attractively. We are not telling him so how attractive he is. Amen. Because if you read in the book of Revelation, he says he's so awesome. He's so bright. If you read of Songs of Solomon, he says, my lover is so awesome. He's handsome. We are not preaching about that. If you understand the grace of God, All the sin is losing its attraction. Now Jesus has become my greatest attraction.
Wow.
In the
world. And
so automatically all the thing.
That's what the scripture says. Taste and see, for the Lord is good.
Yes, absolutely. Now when I fall into sin, I understand that this sin also paid for. When the next time I fall into sin, this sin also paid for. When the third time I fall into sin, I said, if I have such a great God, why can't I stand against this temptation when it comes next time? I feel like standing for my God who stands for me. Like that love increases there. With that love, to say to no sin, the power is increasing. Automatically, because you got a good food, you're throwing all the dirty bones away.
Exactly.
As you said.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, and Jesus, you know, to get people to repent or change their mind, Jesus preached the good news. I say that again, the kingdom.
Yes.
And he painted a picture of where God wanted them to be, and he gave them clear direction on how to get there. And what was the direction? He said them to get there, you have to have faith in me. You have to believe in me. So Jesus gave them directions to. That is to believe in him and to get into the kingdom. He was not pointing them out to sin and all those things or to repentance.
Yeah.
So,
okay,
even, you know, look at this. I want you to see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. Look at Paul. Let's keep what Jesus did aside and look at Paul. He didn't walk into Corinth. And he didn't go there and preach about to turn from sin. In 1 Corinthians 2 verse 2, he said, I don't preach anything, but I preach Christ and him crucified.
Yes, absolutely.
1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 2, he says, I don't preach anything, but I only preach Christ and him crucified.
Yeah, amen.
So he was doing the real job where he was preaching Christ and his good news, and he was preaching him crucified. So when we teach, when we preach about Christ and him crucified, and we become Christ conscious, that is the time that we really live our sinful life and start following him.
That's right. As you said about Jesus Christ, like when he came, he was catering to the different kinds of people. Let's take two sets of people. One is the Pharisees and Sadducees, and another people is the sinners.
Exactly.
Okay. You see, Jesus goes to Zacchaeus' house. Okay. And only by accepting Zacchaeus, giving his love to him, and giving his acceptance to him, though he was a sinner, he accepted him. His love caused him to repent.
Wow. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And
but in the other side, these Pharisees and Sadducees and these people also God wanted them to repent, but they could not repent what the repentance Jesus was preaching. Okay, because as you said, the repentance was not dependent on what they are doing. Repentance is dependent on whether they are ready to believe in Jesus.
Yeah.
Zacchaeus believed in Jesus, and that worked for him. And these people did not believe in Jesus, but they were believing on their sacrifices, their thing, and what they could do. Finally, the real repentance could not come in them.
Absolutely. And I
am I right what I'm trying to say?
Awesome. I really need to add to this. If you really go to see the life of Zacchaeus, Jesus, see, Zacchaeus was a hardcore sinner. We need to understand that.
Zacchaeus
was a hardcore
sinner
during his time. But Jesus says, I'm going to come and have, I'm going to come and dine with you. And I want to come to your house. So when he comes to his house, Jesus is not telling Zacchaeus how much sins and how much of robbery and cheating you have done. But the love of Jesus itself makes Zacchaeus say to Jesus, I'm going to give half of my possession. I'm going to give everything that I've got by cheating to the poor. Jesus never Jesus never preached to him, go, you are a cheater, all the money that you have got from cheating, give it to people. He never preached to him that. He's Jesus, his love and his focus itself on Jesus made him to give up his old nature, old sinful nature. And the same thing happened to Peter. I mean, Peter had given his boat to Jesus to preach his sermon. And Jesus preached maybe for 2, 3, or 5 hours. We don't know, but he preached for a long time. And after he preached all the sermons, yet Peter's life did not change.
Yeah, that's right.
But when Jesus told Peter, come on, let's go fishing. And when Peter got abundant of fish, and, you know, he tried the whole night, he could not get fish. But in the end, when Jesus, because Jesus said, come on, put your net and you will get fish. And when he got abundance of fish, that is when he kneels down to Jesus and said, Lord, I'm not worthy of you.
Yes. So
it was the goodness of Christ that made him forget about his sin and made him realize that Jesus is his Lord and Savior. So if you see Romans chapter 2 verse 4, it says it is the kindness or the goodness of God that leads to repentance.
Yes, amen. Amen.
It is the kindness and goodness of God. So what the point I'm making is, people, God is not calling us preachers to preach repentance. God is calling preachers to preach the gospel.
Yes.
Preaching repentance can't bring salvation into your life. Preaching the gospel, the good news of the kingdom, brings salvation in your life, changes your life, changes everything, your relationship with Christ.
That's right.
You see, because recently I saw a video and it became quite viral, where a guy wears a sackcloth because of this coronavirus. He wears a sackcloth and goes into 10
cities. I saw that, yeah.
He goes into 10 cities and says, repent, 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 and all that stuff. And basically, I think he was trying to imitate John the Baptist. But people don't understand. You see, the first message of John the Baptist was, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus came and said, repent, for the kingdom of God is amidst you. So when he was saying, we don't understand the context. When they came, they were really preaching to the Jews. And what they were saying was, they were saying, the kingdom of the religious kingdom, the Jewish religious system is going to be destroyed and the kingdom of God is going to be established. The kingdom of Jesus, the spiritual kingdom, is going to be established by Jesus dying on the cross. And what they were saying is, in 70 AD, the whole Mosaic kingdom, Mosaic religion, is going to be destroyed in 70 AD. The temple is going to be destroyed. There's going to be a lot of problems that is going to happen. I have a lot of teachings on this, which people consider it as an end time, which is not end times. So I won't speak about that in this episode. People who want to see can check my playlist on YouTube on the end times. You will understand what Jesus is really speaking in this and what John the Baptist was speaking. So when he was speaking, he was not really talking about sins. He was talking about, come on, give up your religious system and start believing in Jesus, for Jesus is coming with his kingdom into this world.
Praise God. Praise God. Absolutely.
Okay. So this is I wanted to tell my viewers, it's not about putting the sackcloth. This is not applicable at this point of time. You can't go and tell you are going to get destroyed because you are sinning.
Great.
Salvation doesn't.
So, but last one word of.
Yeah, salvation doesn't come by preaching repentance. Salvation comes by preaching the good news of Jesus. That's what I want to say. Yeah, go ahead, Christopher.
Yeah, if you read in Hebrews chapter 10, as we said, God has already paid the price. If you read Hebrews chapter 9 and 10, there are so many times, more than five times, the Bible clearly say that God was the once and for all sacrifice. And Bible says in Hebrews 10:14, by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified.
Wow.
Understand, right? So he has perfected, he has sanctified us, and he has given us the solid foundation. And on the finished work of Jesus Christ, we are already cleansed, we are already purified. Stand on that platform. Okay. Yeah. So people may ask, once we are become a believer, so that there is no more sanctification, there is no more purification. You see, you have to stand on that. First, God has already sanctified you, purified you. You have to stand on that platform. Okay. Then Bible says in Ephesians 5, I believe, once you believe in Jesus Christ, you are a bride of Jesus Christ. Not that. He is a bride and a bridegroom. The Bible says, and now you are a bride of Jesus Christ, and now Jesus is the bridegroom. He has taken the responsibility of bringing you to that perfection. If there is any habit problem, that problem, he takes the responsibility of cleansing you, purifying you by washing of the water.
Yeah.
By washing of the water, and he will take you and he will present you blameless before the Father. Amen. So what happened in Christian life, we don't say once you become a believer that you will not commit sin, that you will not this and all. We are not trying to say that point here. You may fall here and there, but Jesus will cleanse you, purify you by washing of the water. That the word, whenever the word comes, through the word, he will put you in order. He will tell you, okay, this is what you are not doing right. It's not more of not condemning you, but he will correct you. He will correct you. He will bring you to that place. If you have done something wrong, and he is not going to ask you to do some penance and come out of that thing, believe that it is forgiven. And when God corrects you, take the correct, take a chance. See, what happened? Law, when you miss the mark, it doesn't give you a chance to rise up. You see the adult, the woman who was caught in adultery, and nobody was ready to give her a second chance. Am I right?
Yes.
Nobody was ready to give her a second chance.
Yeah.
That's what law, when you miss, law will never give you a chance. But in new covenant grace, when you fall, Jesus comes and gives her a chance and say, I don't condemn you. Now go and sin no more. And that's what our believers, God is telling us now. When we speak about repentance, it's better to give this point also. As a believer, you fall here and there. Yeah. Now, God is not saying once you have fallen, it's finished forevermore, no more forgiveness. God is not saying that. You have fallen. God says to you one thing. See, you have fallen. I don't condemn you. I have forgiven this sin also, what you have committed just 5 minutes before. I have done it. I have cleansed it. Now, he's telling you, rise up and go and sin no more. And when you receive the love of God, and that leads you to a true repentance.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's so amazing, Christopher. We are almost about to finish.
Closing our time.
This is so amazing that today's discussion was And you know, that's what God does not need our permission or even our repentance to forgive us. He forgave us already before we were born, actually. You see?
Amen.
Yeah. So if you read Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7, it says, He forgave you before you were born in accordance with the riches of His grace.
Amen. Amen. Amazing. Yes.
Yeah. So that's amazing, Christopher. Today, this evening, we are here and we are to share our views on repentance, and it's been so fruitful today. And I'm sure that everybody who is watching us live are getting blessed by what Brother Christopher has shared, what I am sharing about repentance.
Amen.
You know, people have a very, very wrong notion, and they believe that people who preach grace do preach they tell people to sin more. It's not that. In fact, we don't look at sin, we look at Christ. And when we focus more on Christ, sin automatically goes away. Yeah.
Amen.
Yes. Yes. So this evening, let's wind up today. Wind up this session, and I want to thank once again Brother Christopher for being with us. Any questions that you want us to answer, any discussion, any doubts, please feel free to contact me or Pastor Christopher on his Facebook, on his Messenger, on his YouTube. You can comment, or on my Facebook, Messenger, and YouTube, or Instagram. We are here to discuss and bless you. So we are open for any discussion, any doubts, and any clarification. We love you, and keep watching us, and keep viewing our upcoming episodes. Very soon we are going to come up with confession, a topic on confession, where the Christians are called to confess their sin. So we see you soon. God bless you. Thank you, Christopher.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, Arnold, and thank you, viewers. God bless you.
God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.